Lord, brothers and sisters, can you hear me? Okay, praise the Lord. Yes. We are so thankful to the Lord for bringing us to the last Lord's Day of this 2021. We are so thankful unto the Lord for his faithfulness. As our brother has been reminding us many times, that there is death and chaos, ungodliness and lawlessness, danger and killings and murders, uncertainties. In all these, the Lord has kept us, and he has really surrounded us with himself. Otherwise, we cannot sit in this manner. We cannot gather in this manner. So we are so thankful to the Lord. Loving Father, we are so thankful for thy great jealousy towards us, that you have kept us, oh wonderful Lord, to yourself. And in that keeping, you have kept us in your Son. We cannot keep ourselves. We cannot remain. But it is your power, the power of the cross, the power of the life of Christ, and the power of his burial and resurrection, and the power of his glorification, even his intercession on our behalf in the heavenlies, within the veil, in the holy of holies of the heavenlies. That's where we are kept, O Lord. We are so thankful. Enable us, O Lord, tonight, this morning, to hear your voice and obey that voice. Those of us, O Lord, whom you have given the grace to be the sons of God, O Lord, all of us, the all believers, female brothers and brothers, all of us, Lord, we come to you with grateful heart, with expectant hearts to hear your word. And we also pray for those who have not yet received you as their Lord and Savior. May they come to the repentance and faith, O Lord, given by you in grace. So, Lord, bless this vessel completely. O Lord, efface me wholly, completely, and only you live, and make me very humble, broken, wholly, completely, O Lord, that only Christ be seen and heard. O Lord, I ask all this in the most highly exalted name of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So, loving brothers and sisters, the greatest need of all believers and the Church of God right now is in this world, those who are still alive, there are two great things. One, do you know what is God doing? One thing, do you know what is God doing? Secondly, do you know what is God's time? These two things must be a priority for each believer, for each family, and for each assembly, wherever we meet, wherever we live, wherever we have our daily routine. Once again, two things. What is God doing? Secondly, what is his time? Genesis chapter 7 and verse 1. Genesis chapter 7 and verse 1. And that verse says very clearly, yes, the Lord ordered, commanded Noah to build the ark. But in this verse he says, and the Lord said unto Noah, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. So the most important thing is these days is, yes, we are the Church of God. Yes, we are the assembly of God. Yes, we are the saved ones, believers of God. But have we heard the Lord say unto us, come thou and all thy house into the ark? And we know very well, dearly beloved, that the ark right now is the Lord Jesus Christ and his assembly, whose head he is. So dearly beloved, remember that. Then Genesis 7, verse 16, it says here, and they went in, Genesis 7, 16, and they that went in, went in male and female, all flesh, as God had commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. And the Lord shut him in. The Lord doesn't say that the Lord shut Noah and his family. But the Lord said they went in. But the Lord shut in Noah. Because the Lord had a dealing and a covenant with Noah. Noah means, dearly beloved, rest. The word Noah means rest. It is the same word Nehemiah. Remember that. That is also rest, dearly beloved. So here we are this morning, and we heard that great message this morning, how our Lord became poor voluntarily, and how he has made us rich with himself. The richness of God is the fullness of God. The richness of God is all the availability of God himself. That is the richness of God. And that richness cannot be had, means we cannot have it. We cannot have that richness unless and until we are in his Son, dearly beloved. So we are so thankful. So let us turn once again this morning. Today we are going to see, in as the Lord would enable us, that the man Christ Jesus, all the fullness of God dwelleth in the body of Jesus Christ. We know it very well. Colossians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. They are very, very important. This Jesus Christ, who is the embodiment of God, for in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. So dearly beloved, let us, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. So dearly beloved, let us remember this Christ who emptied himself. It's a very great, great understanding. We must know that this, the emptying of Christ, so that he can take all in him himself, and that what he has done. One more thing, dearly beloved, Christ is the door. Christ is the door, not of the fold, but of the flock. This is very mysterious. How can be there a door of a flock, not of a fold? That the sheep together, it's open, but there is a door. And that door is Christ. And remember that. Remember the word, the Lord shut him in. The Godhead shut him in. So on that last day, when the white throne judgment will come, please listen to this carefully. When on the last day, the white throne judgment will come, the door that is Christ will be shut, and no one be able to avail himself or herself of the grace of God. But until that day, even in tribulation, God is going to save many, many, many more. But dearly beloved, as far as we are concerned, we are in the ark. We are inside the flock of Christ. And we have the liberty, according to John chapter 10, to go out and come back in. Go out and come back in. Because whenever we go out, it is without the camp, outside the camp where Christ is working. But when we are in, it's a very great mystery. Every believer who lives in the consciousness of his oneness, what union life with Christ, very important. Listen to these words. The union life with Christ is always out and in at the same time. Out where without the camp, according to Hebrews chapter 13, where Christ is, and in, that is according to all that Hebrews says, that we are within the veil by his blood into the heavenlies, according to also Ephesians 1:3. Very important that he has blessed us with all the spiritual blessings in his Son, to be holy and blameless before him. So remember, those who, please listen to me, you and I must know this fact, that we are in and out at the same moment in Christ, because we are the part of the flock, not of any fold. May you read chapter 10 of John, and may the Lord begin to open to you all the treasures of the union life of Christ with the head of the believer and the family of believers and the assembly of believers. So here we turn to Colossians chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, which is the prayer of Saint Paul. And there we read Colossians chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. That their hearts, this is the prayer of Paul, and it prays for us, that their hearts, that is our hearts, may be comforted, that we being knit together in love, we, he's praying for us, that they being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, that they may know, means we may know, we, all of us, the mystery of God, even Christ, in whom are all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge hidden. Dearly beloved, this is the purpose of God in the incarnation of Christ Jesus, and Saint Paul prays according to the Holy Spirit inspired him. The Holy Spirit inspired him to pray for the entire church, from the first believer to the last believer, and belonging to us right now, that we may be comforted, we may be encouraged, we may be really be able to endure this terrible contradiction, that we are in flesh, we are in self, we are in this rotten world, we are in the sinful state even right now, but we are delivered. And so we need that strength, that power of what? That they may knit together in love. In love that is in Christ, the head. That union life with Christ, dearly beloved. Very important. If you have time, please read all the Ascension Psalms. That is Psalm 120 onwards, the 15 Psalms. From 120 onwards, they deeply talk of the union life with the head and the life of God. So please read all those things. May you, why I'm telling this? This is the last day of the last Lord's Day of this year. And it is very important that when we begin the new year, when we enter into the new times that the Lord is going to bring to us. These times are very, very, very dangerous times, very critical times, and times of rejoicing, and times of strength and power, and strength, and the times of rest in Christ. Remember that, rest in Christ. So, dearly beloved, this is the purpose of God, that we must be knit together in love, that is Christ, unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding. See, what is it? The riches, see here, the word. Once again, the brother spoke of riches. And I was asking the Lord, Lord, if you really want this message, give me the hint in the very first message that you would bring that would relate to this. Otherwise, give me other word. But he stamped it with the stamp of his approval. The Lord became poor. Why? So that we may have unto all the riches of the full assurance of understanding. Dearly beloved, it is very important to know the reality of our life in Christ. We must know the reality of our life in Christ, that they may know the mystery of what is the assurance of understanding. The assurance of our understanding, or the riches of that full assurance, is this, that we may know the mystery of God, even Christ. The mystery of God is Christ, dearly beloved. The treasure of God is Christ. All that is Christ, dearly beloved. And we'll know there is much about this, dearly beloved. Salvation, let me tell you according to the word of God. Salvation is the tip of the Christian life. It is not all Christian life. But without salvation, you cannot begin. So those who do not know the Lord in their lives as their personal savior, they are not even the tip of the life of God. So they are in a very dangerous situation. So I appeal to those who are listening to the word of God right now. If you have not given your heart to the Lord, if you have not accepted the Lord Jesus as a personal savior, you are in a very dangerous situation. At right now, the door is open. The door of grace is open. But the day is coming for each one. Each man is allotted. Each person is allotted. Each boy and girl, each man and woman is allotted a time of grace. And when that time of grace is missed, the door will be shut for you. The door will be shut for you. So here it is, dearly beloved. For now, this Christ Jesus, this mystery of Christ Jesus, who is he? 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. Who is he? The 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. For there is one God and one mediator also between God and men, himself, man, Christ Jesus. God and men. He means to say that this person, Jesus Christ, is the only and only one unique man that ever was or ever will be that can intercede on our behalf, that who has mediated on our behalf, advocated on our behalf, who became substitute, who died in our place, taking all the wrath of God on himself, the judgment of God, dearly beloved. And that's how he is the mediator. First of all, saving us, redeeming us, delivering us. And right now, God knows that even after being saved, it is very difficult for sinful men in the flesh, to remain in this body and soul and spirit. The Lord knows it is very difficult for man to remain pure, holy, sinless, victorious, pleasing his Father and God, so that life is fully available to us. Why is Christ Jesus, mediator right now in the heavenlies? Why, dearly beloved? Because we need him alone for it to be purity, for holiness, for sinlessness, for victorious life, and to be pleasing to God all the time. Remember yesterday's word. What did it say? Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill towards men, in whom he is well pleased. See? Only those in whom he is well pleased will be in rapture. Write it down. Those will be, and they are, those who are saved. According to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 12, very important. God, who has called us to be worthy of God, who has called us to his kingdom and glory. Remember that you would walk worthy of God, walk, who hath called you unto his kingdom and glory. Dearly beloved, we are saved, but we are called to this great purpose of his kingdom and glory. And those who are only pleasing to him, they will be in rapture. Yes, those who will not be lost, nobody will be lost. Those who are believers will never lose salvation, will never lose heaven, will never lose eternal life. But the kingdom and glory are reserved for those who are as much as the Lord would have them in his Son. So remember that. So the manhood of Christ Jesus does not overly try to pale the divinity of Christ, but it emphasizes the fact that apart from this unique person, man Christ Jesus, there could not be a permanent eternal mediation. Permanent eternal mediation is in Christ Jesus, and therefore he is the head of the church forever and ever and ever and ever. So remember that this man, Christ Jesus, dearly beloved. So who is this Christ Jesus? The Christ Jesus is 1 Timothy 3:16. 1 Timothy 3:16. We are go according to the word of God. Let us read. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Remember that the word mystery, in Colossians chapter 2 and verse 2, we read that they may know the mystery of God, even Christ. See, last part. That they may know the mystery of God, even Christ. So here in 1 Timothy 3:16, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. He who was manifested in the flesh, that's Christ Jesus, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached among the nations, believed on in the world, received up in glory. This is Christ Jesus, dearly beloved. He is the mystery of God. See, without any controversy. No one can argue against it. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. And when this baby Jesus was born, he was the mystery of God in the godliness, and the evil one could not do anything, dearly beloved, to stop the baby to be born. Remember that. And that was the victory, the triumph, and therefore glory to God in the highest. Wonderful, isn't it, dearly beloved? But those who do not know him as personal savior, they cannot understand the thrill and the wonder of the incarnation of Christ Jesus. Dearly beloved, when the Lord has given us the privilege to be born into his family, we are given the wonderment the thrill, romance Gujarati, the thrill of experiencing the man Christ Jesus in our life. So without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. And that the mystery of godliness is Christ, who was manifested in the flesh. Oh, he became flesh, dearly beloved, justified in the spirit. How? See, this man, he came in flesh and he was justified in the spirit. What does it mean? He lived a pure, God-pleasing, holy, sinless life and justified man. That man is pleasing to God. He justified you and me, dearly beloved. You have to understand this deeply. Justified in the spirit. Seen of angels. The angels saw. They said, Lord, Christ is born. What did they say? They saw man Christ Jesus. Remember that. They saw him eternity before, past, the Son of God in the spirit. But here they saw the Son of Man and the Son of God in the baby Christ, in the young Christ, the Christ on the cross, the body of Christ in the grave, and the soul and spirit of Christ in hell, dearly beloved, as he conquered death and hell and make part of Hades of believers paradise, dearly beloved. This is man Christ Jesus. This is man Christ Jesus on my behalf, on your behalf, on our behalf. So remember that. Justified in the scene of angels, preached among the nations. And we know it very well. We know very well the last part of Matthew chapter 28 and also Mark 16 and also Luke 24 and also John's Gospel chapter 21. And we know the first part also of the book of Acts, both first chapter and the second chapter. And we know Revelation itself. All this, dearly beloved, this is the nation, believed in the world. We have believed the Lord Jesus Christ, not after death, but in this sinful flesh, in this sinful body, we have believed the Lord Jesus Christ, this man Christ Jesus, dearly beloved. It's very important. Beloved, believed on the world, received up in glory. He is received up in the glory. See, wonderful, isn't it? He is believed on in the world every day, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, until he comes. But he is received in the glory. As I told you, the life of a Christian is a life in the head, both in and out at the same time. In and out. Without the camp. And within the way, two things. Remember your state. Here it says very clearly, as we read Colossians chapter 2, verse 2, that unto all riches of the full assurance of the understanding. I remind us, all of us, even myself, that we have to understand unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, that you may know the mystery of God. The mystery of God is revealed here to us. Who is this Christ? Who was this Christ in the earth? That he came in flesh. He came in flesh, manifested in flesh, justified in the spirit, seen by the angels. Remember that. Preached among the nations, believed all in the world, and received up in glory. This is man Christ Jesus. This is the riches. This is the riches, dearly beloved, the Christ. It is not riches, 1, 2, 3, 4. No, it is the riches, Christ himself. Remember that. We do not need any other riches. We do not need any other riches. We have the riches, the person, that is Christ. Man Christ Jesus, who became flesh, who justified manhood. when he completed and perfected, dearly beloved, the law of God, obedience, he was justified in the spirit. Man's body and man's spirit became alive to God in Christ Jesus, dearly beloved. This is it. And then preached in the among the nations, believed on in the world, and received in glory. And dearly beloved, you and I are right now there in the glory. According to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, what was our horrible situation in the first verses of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3 verses? Oh, we were dead in trespasses and sins, and we were walking according to the standard of this world, according to what? The prince of the power of the air, the devil. But then what happened? God made us alive in Christ Jesus, chapter 4, verse 4 and 5 and 6, and raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. This is man Christ Jesus, dearly beloved. This is man, and this is the riches of Christ Jesus, dearly beloved. So now, from now onwards, daily experience the in and out life with Christ. Every day, every moment, and we'll enjoy. You will enjoy the triumph of Christ, the victory of Christ, the conquest of Christ, dearly beloved. And you will enjoy three things. Galatians 2:20. One. This is one thing. This crucified life of Christ. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That is 2:20. Now, Galatians 5:24. When you are in the experience, experimental, that is of 2:20, then you come here. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. We don't need any fleshly affections. We don't need anything, dearly beloved, because we have now crucified. And therefore, 6:14, Galatians 6:14. Therefore, but God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. See? What has happened inside in me? In Galatians 2:20, which I experience every day, Galatians 5:24, keeps me full of, you know what? Complete redemption from the worldliness. Complete redemption from the worldliness. Galatians 5:6:14, dearly beloved, crucified life. The cross, write it down. The cross of Christ is the great exchange, eternal exchange house for death and life. That's where you get the death of Christ, the all benefits, and the life of Christ. Dearly beloved, that is the exchange house. Christ is the exchange house where the death of Christ, not our death, our co-death with Christ, okay, but not our separate independent death. No. Co-death with Christ. Co-burial with Christ. Co-rising with Christ. Co-ascension and glorification with Christ. Dearly beloved. This is the experiential life of man Christ Jesus. This is the experiential life, daily life of the man Christ Jesus in each believer, which God expects, God demands, and he provides all the resources, that is all the resources of God, to come to this is Christ again, nothing but Christ. And that is the faith, as it is written in chapter 2, I don't have the time to go there, but Colossians 2, as you have received Christ, walk ye in him. As you have received Christ, it is in chapter 2, walk ye in him, dearly beloved. By faith, we received Christ as Savior. Now by faith, we knowing all this assurance, the deep assurance of the understanding of the riches of the fullness of Christ, that the mystery of God is Christ. And that mystery is revealed in us, expressed in us, and it must be expressed daily. And only that life, that individual challenge the world and the worldly people, dearly beloved. So without control, we saw that. And so here that is, we know very well why this is, Lord, dearly beloved, why it is no. When you have this, once again, we come to the first thing that we saw, that we are comforted. We are comforted. We are being comforted. Our hearts are being comforted. And we are knit together in love. See? Why is there so much, dearly beloved, pain between husband and wife in the family, in the assembly? You know why? Because they do not know the love of God, the love of Christ, and they are not knit together in Him. Because when you say something, anyway, something, when you are not on the same page, what can there be? When you are at the same level, what can there be? Just go on with quietness, with silence, and go on. But pray that all husband and wives, all families, all believers would come to this experience of being knit together in love. That's not worldly love. That is not the love of the flesh. That is not the love of the fellowship of eating together, singing, dancing. No. It is being knit together with the head, that is Christ. Man Christ Jesus. Dearly beloved, knit together. And when we have that full assurance of understanding that we may know what we know, that this is Christ in my wife, this is Christ in my husband, this is Christ in my brother, in the assembly, this is the Christ in my sister, in the assembly, this is the Christ in that assembly, this is in that group. They meet in different way. Yes, they are Pentecostal. They are this, they are that. But dearly beloved, when we are knit together in love, the mystery of Christ becomes alive in us. And people will wonder. People wondered at Christ. Why? Because He was a mystery. Why was He a mystery? Because He lived His life in oneness with God, His Father. With oneness with God, His Father. And they wondered, and therefore Nicodemus came and saw and told Him, "We know that the things that you do, no one can do unless and until God is with him." Dearly beloved, the angels and others will be witnesses and say, "Yes, this man, he was weak. He was full of faults. He was so much, but one thing is sure, something was different that kept him alive, that kept him joyous, that kept him at peace, that kept him loving." What was that? Oneness, the union life with Christ, which Christ has, a union life with God as man. Remember, man Christ Jesus means the union life of God with man. With man Christ Jesus. And that you and I can have only by being born again, by deeply knowing Christ in ourselves and experiencing His life moment by moment and expressing it, dearly beloved. So now this Christ Jesus is very, very important, dearly beloved. And remember, when Christ Jesus came into the world, and right now, what is God doing? God is magnifying Himself. He is glorifying Himself. Magnification of God or magnifying of God is, what is it? God does not become you know, expanded under a microscope. No, God cannot be put under a microscope. One has to go nearer and nearer to see the bigger and larger infinite infinity of God. And where can you see that? In man, Christ Jesus, in the head, only there. And where there you can experience the magnifying of God and glorifying of God is an experience. It is an experience, it is the outcome of having God, beholding Him, hearing Him, experiencing Him, Christ living in us, dearly beloved. And remember, the Lord Jesus Christ as man had an eightfold message. Eightfold message, which I will quickly say, and then I shall end there. But I would like to pray and say to everyone, please come to the saving knowledge. And those who are faltering, those who are backslidden, please come back to the head, that man Christ Jesus. So what is the message, this eightfold message? Now let me tell you, this eightfold message is given by, first of all, was given by John the Baptist. Then second, given by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Then Peter, then Paul, and then Saint John. Same message, it doesn't change. And all the men of God must have this message. And what is this message? First, it is the kingdom of God. Kingdom of God, Matthew 4, 12 and 17. Matthew 4, 12 and 17. The first is kingdom of God, dearly beloved. Matthew chapter 4, verse 12. What does it? Now Jesus had heard, John was casting, he departed into Galilee. Verse 17. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. See, first of all, Jesus did not say that just this, but kingdom of God. And then why? The second is repentance. It is there. We see that. Repentance. Second is repentance. Thirdly, it is baptism. John 3, 26. John 4, 1 and 2. Be baptized. Be baptized. And they came into John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizer, and all men come to him. See? Jesus Christ, baptism. That is the third. The fourth is faith. John 3, 16. John 3:16, faith. 3:16. We know it very well. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And then, fourth is there, dearly beloved. Then, remission of sins. Fifthly, that is Mark 2:10. Remission of sin. Forgiveness of sin. But they may know that the Son of Man that had power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the sick of the palsy, forgiveness is very important. Forgiveness of sin, very, very important, dearly beloved. All these are very important. Then fifth, remission of sins. Then sixthly, evidence of the work of Christ living in you. Evidence of the work, Matthew 7, 16 to 19. Matthew 7, 16 to 19. See, ye shall know them by their fruit. Do men gather grapes from thorns or figs from thistles? 17th verse and 19th verse. Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. Verse 18. And good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, and neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. And therefore, verse 19, every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. So good works are preached by the Lord Jesus Christ. It is not, they are not excluded. Remember that. That is the sixth evidence of the work. We saw it very well. Then the seventh is the new society, the church. The new man, that is Christ. Some time ago, a brother preached about this, that there's a new race, new mankind, and it is there, and that we are, dearly beloved. That is also there. Matthew 16 and 18. Matthew 16 and 18. Matthew 18 and 17. Matthew 16 and 18. And I say unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. See, the gate cannot. Right from his very birth, the gates of hell could not prevail against him, because he was conceived by the Holy Spirit, filled by the Holy Spirit, lived by the Holy Spirit, depending on him, completely in union with God the Father, dearly beloved. So that is it. As Matthew 18:17. And if he shall neglect to hear them, tell them of the church. But if he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee as an heathen man and a publican. So anyone who is in the church, listening to the church, keeping in the discipline of the church, dearly beloved, he is continuing in the fellowship. That is important. The Lord Jesus Christ himself taught this. And lastly, very important, baptism in the Holy Spirit. John 14:16. Baptism in the Holy Spirit. You cannot exclude this. One must be baptized in the Holy Spirit, dearly beloved. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, dearly beloved. That is the Holy Spirit himself. And 20, 22, and 23. Okay, then Acts 1:4-8. Acts 1:4-8. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. And verse 8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the world. So this life only can be lived in the power of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit baptizes us into the body of Christ. So dearly beloved, remember this man, Christ Jesus. But this can be had only by first being born again, by being forgiven of forgiveness of sins received. And all these 8 things we must be mindful of. May the Lord bless us abundantly. Amen.